This is Eyewitness News on LA 56 with live breaking news.
Breaking news, traffic jammed as police activity shuts down all lanes on the 60 freeway in Ontario. This is Eyewitness News at 8 on LA 56. I'm Colleen Sullivan.
I'm Mark Brown. This is live pictures you're looking at from Air 7 HD. All eastbound lanes of the 60 freeway at Euclid Avenue in Ontario are closed right now. And the reason is that there is a man down there with a knife and who may be, according to police, suicidal. He at one time was on the overpass. Now he's on the freeway proper. At one point he laid down in traffic lanes. So they have the all lanes shut down, and you can imagine what that is doing to traffic in the area. It is a really bad nightmare now for people as police deal with that individual to try to get him out of there, and until then, you're advised to avoid the area. Now, to an Eyewitness News exclusive, the mother of twins seen on video being abused by a nanny is speaking out. She says the children may have been traumatized, afraid to sleep when that nanny was in the house. Eyewitness News reporter Miriam Hernandez has more on this heartbreaking story.
She was nice. I mean, we did a trial period. She was good with my older kids.
And there are times on this footage, nanny Dana Cash does seem nice, here hugging the one-year-old boy. But then, in another shot with the boy's twin sister, her patience seems to break.
And she spins her around, has her hand over her mouth, and shakes her and screams, no.
The children's mother, who wishes to remain anonymous, says Cash had a clean record, according to her research. So we wondered then, what can a parent do to find a responsible care provider or detect behavior that could be harming your child?
So what we're trying to do is make sure.
Vonda Dennis is a certified specialist in parenthood and child care. Today she's training women who will be teaching child care. One sign of a good nanny, she says, a background in early childhood education.
That kind of shows us something about what your field of study is, what you actually, where your love and your passion lies.
About a nanny cam, she says, too late. Your child has already been traumatized. While the footage might provide evidence for prosecution, better, she says, to watch for changes in your child's behavior. Anything unusual happening that doesn't seem good.
Any excessive crying, if that's not what the child normally does. Anything, if the aggression, or actually if they draw away.
In this case, it was an older brother seen in the video who told the parents about this particular incident. But the mother tells us it then took her hours of tedious scrolling through the video to find it and other questionable acts. She says she realized too late the babies had been showing signs of distress, but she thought it was just a phase.
They had been getting up at night crying and been crying more, you know, in the evening when we were with them and just more restless.
But after Cash left,
they're back to their happy selves, and we realize now that it was probably her.
Dennis says another reason to tune into your child, nanny cams may fail. Your instincts won't.
We must look to our children for the answers. They are there.
Miriam Hernandez, ABC 7 Eyewitness News.
And tonight, that suspect, Dana Cash, is out on bail. She has not been arraigned yet, and the case is still being investigated.
A Harvard University student who grew up in Long Beach found himself stuck in Mexico. Dario Guerrero wasn't born in this country, and he went to Mexico to help his mother get cancer treatment. Under immigration law, he effectively deported himself. Eyewitness News reporter Amy Powell has his emotional story.
Dario Guerrero Meneses has been living with his grandparents in a gang-controlled suburb of Mexico City for months, stuck in the country he was born in because of an immigration issue. The Harvard University film student was 2 years old when he moved to Southern California illegally with his family. He returned to Mexico this year to take his dying mother to a clinic for chemotherapy, knowing it was a risky decision.
And near the end, we decided we couldn't wait any longer because of my mom's condition, so we decided to just leave anyways.
The third-year Harvard student, an aspiring filmmaker, had been living in the U.S. without fear of deportation thanks to a 2012 Obama administration rule.
It makes no sense to expel talented young people who, for all intents and purposes, are Americans.
But under that rule, leaving the country without permission from federal authorities meant he couldn't return.
I waited a month and a half. I submitted 2 expedite requests to have my application expedited, but there was no decision made on my application in time.
Harvard University has been supportive of Guerrero, granting him leave from his studies. His professors say he's an exceptional writer.
Dario really undertook every moment of his education that I saw on his own terms.
Guerrero was at his mother's side when she died in August.
And I don't think I'd be able to forgive myself for letting her basically continue the decline in her condition only because of my legal status.
Amy Powell, ABC 7 Eyewitness News.
Guerrero is expected to return to the U.S. in a few days.
The LAPD says it has put the brakes on so-called ghost cars on patrol. An officer went to the inspector general, the department's watchdog, saying that patrol numbers were being falsified to show that staffing levels were being met when in fact they were not. According to the report, police logs showed officers were out patrolling when in fact they were performing other duties, such as desk work or working with other units that took them away from their patrol duties.
It is not part of the culture of the Los Angeles Police Department. This is not something that we condone, that we encourage, or that we foster through our policies.
This practice created safety concerns for any officer on patrol throughout the city of Los Angeles and gave the public misperception that more officers were out patrolling their neighborhoods when in fact they were not.
The LAPD says public safety was never compromised.
Former LA City Councilman Richard Alarcon is headed to county jail. He and his wife were sentenced after being convicted of voter fraud and perjury. The judge sentenced Alarcon to 120 days in jail and 5 years probation. His wife, Flora, got 5 years probation and 400 hours of community service. The couple was convicted of voter fraud and perjury for living outside the district he represented. They plan to appeal. About 1,700 students in Huntington Beach have missed several days of school because of possible asbestos exposure. The students affected go to Hopeview, Oakview, and Lakeview elementary schools. The school district says those schools will undergo asbestos abatement while students attend classes at 9 nearby schools starting on Thursday. Transportation will be provided by the district. Parents were notified of the relocation plan today, but some parents still plan to transfer their kids to other districts permanently.
LA Mayor Eric Garcetti is ordering big changes in the way the city uses water. The mayor signed a directive calling for the city to cut its water use by 20% over 5 years. He wants a 50% cut in the amount of imported water purchased by the DWP. Garcetti also ordered city agencies to reduce landscape watering and to replace lawns. And he urged residents to voluntarily reduce outdoor watering to 2 days a week.
Alarming new numbers today in the fight against Ebola. Those who come down with the virus have a 30% survival rate, and the number of people getting infected is expected to get worse before it gets better. Today, President Obama and health officials are taking aggressive measures to fight Ebola. This as the Dallas nurse infected with the virus has been upgraded to good condition.
The CDC still has no idea how 26-year-old Nina Pham, the Dallas nurse, got infected with Ebola. Pham was on the team caring for Thomas Eric Duncan, who died last week.
A single infection in a healthcare worker is unacceptable. And what we're doing at this point is looking at everything we can do to minimize that risk so those who are caring for her do that safely and effectively.
Pham has received a potentially life-saving transfusion from Dr. Kent Brantley, the missionary who recently survived Ebola. His blood is now packed with antibodies to fight the virus. The procedure appears to be working. Pham released a statement today saying, quote, "I am doing well and want to thank everyone for their kind wishes and prayers. I am blessed by the support of family and friends and am blessed to be cared for by the best team of doctors and nurses in the world here at Texas Health Presbyterian Hospital, Dallas." President Obama says finding out how Pham was infected is a priority.
We are surging resources into Dallas to examine what exactly has happened that ended up infecting the nurse there.
The CDC is sending a second 9-person team to Dallas. CDC Director Tom Frieden says a specialized team may have prevented Pham from contracting the virus.
And, you know, I've thought often about it. I wish we had put a team like this on the ground the day the first patient was diagnosed. That might have prevented this infection. But we will do that from today onward with any case anywhere in the U.S.
Meantime, a grim forecast coming from the World Health Organization. It warns that West Africa could see up to 10,000 new cases of Ebola per week within 2 months.
And Facebook CEO Mark Zuckerberg announced today he is donating $25 million to help fight Ebola. Stay with Eyewitness News for all the latest developments in the Ebola crisis. We also have resources on abc7.com to help you understand this potentially deadly virus.
Going to take a first look at our weather in the 8 o'clock hour. Jonathan Novak is here with us. Jonathan?
Hey, Mark, cooler today. We saw the clouds this morning really stubborn. Live Nugget Doppler 7000 HD showing, well, we have some bigger changes ahead. Some rain up to the northwest portions of the country that is associated with a system that's going to be rolling through overnight. And you see the clouds already socking in over Southern California. Tomorrow morning, mid-60s, but we're only at 71 by noontime. Chance of light rain. Temperatures dropping for Wednesday. We have a warm-up, though, a little bit in that forecast. I'll tell you about that coming up in the full 7 minutes.
All right. Thanks, Jonathan.
Yep.
President Obama is hosting a summit on dealing with the terror group ISIS. The president met with defense ministers from more than 20 nations at Andrews Air Force Base outside Washington, D.C. The goal of the summit is to take stock of what has already been done about ISIS and lay out plans for the next steps, including who will be involved and in what capacity.
I'm encouraged by the unanimity of viewpoints and the commitment of the countries involved to make sure that we're making steady progress.
The U.S. continued airstrikes against ISIS targets in the Syrian town of Kobani. More than 200,000 residents have fled into Turkey, and the U.N. has warned of a potential massacre by ISIS if it were to gain control of the town.
Up next here at 8, call it the ultimate in teamwork. An eyewitness catches a dramatic rescue using a human chain across dangerous waters, plus this.
These pastors basically said, no, you need to come over here and take a look at this.
What caused the wall panels of this plane to start popping out in midair, and what happened next?
And Facebook and Apple telling female employees they will pay to freeze their eggs. The new debate tonight.
A dramatic rescue off the coast of Oregon. It's all caught on video. 8 people stuck on some rocks as the tide rushed in. 3 of them jumped into the water to try to swim to shore. Beachgoers saw what was going on and formed a human chain, pulling the 3 from the ocean to safety. A Coast Guard helicopter rescued the other 5 from the rocks. 1 person was taken to the hospital for treatment.
Terrifying moments in the sky. The wall inside the passenger plane buckling and cracking after takeoff. Some passengers feared the worst was about to happen. ABC's David Curley tells us why they had to convince the pilot to land right away.
Frightened passengers as seams split on this 757 right after takeoff.
Bang, 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 bang.
And then the interior panels buckled in.
That's right. The inside wall seams burst.
Wasn't for sure if we were going to make it.
Up in the cockpit, no alarm of a pressurization problem. The masks didn't deploy, but some of the 184 passengers on their way to Dallas wanted the crew to take a look.
These passengers basically said, no, you need to come over here and take a look at this.
First a flight attendant, and then a pilot slips into the row to take a look at how that liner split. And that was enough.
We do have a potential problem in the back.
It was an air duct between the fuselage and the liner that blew. American Airlines, whose 757s average 19 years old, called it a cosmetic problem.
There are things that can fail, and sometimes spectacularly. I'm sure these people were quite scared when something like this happened, but at no time were they in any real danger.
We've seen plenty of problems inside cabins. This American Airlines jet had to land because seats were not bolted in. But concerning is when a fuselage fails, like this Southwest jet, on which a piece of the skin peeled back.
It's the outer skin that's the most important. This is where that liner would be attached. So you can see there's a lot of room for wires and ducts that you never see. And this was a lot of noise, but no safety danger. David Curley, ABC News, Washington Reagan Airport.
Now to our evolving weather. And Jonathan Novak talking about the cool down.
We like a little rain. We like a little cooler weather, and I got both for you as we head through tomorrow. It was cloudy today. The clouds were really stubborn, and that kept us very cool. You know, guys, we were over 10 degrees cooler in some spots today than yesterday. What a big drop. And in Malibu, what a beautiful time lapse showing the low cloud cover rolling over Malibu and the hills there. It's very nice. Okay, so let's get to another image of that, which is actually really cool to see. This is a visible satellite. It starts here at 10 a.m. You see how far inland the marine layer pushed today. Everybody in the valleys, the coastal slopes saw those clouds, and that will be the case tomorrow again. So much so that we've got a chance of light rain with those clouds, with that moisture pushing in. Live Megadolphin 7000 HD, check out the top of your screen all the way in the Pacific Northwest. That's the next weather system that is really affecting our weather, already kept us cool, and as it comes through the area tonight, overnight, that's going to mean rain chances in the forecast. Our high was 76 today in downtown, normally at 79, and temperatures tonight are very cool. You say, well, that's still kind of close to what we had this time last night. Well, in fact, in some spots, we're 8 to 11 degrees cooler right now than this time last night. Believe it or not, from Burbank to Van Nuys, it's even 13 degrees cooler right now in Santa Clarita than this time last night. So the inland area is very chilly this evening. Once again, tomorrow, that'll be the case. So here's high pressure, way out of the picture. No warm weather ahead for us anytime soon, so we're looking at what this next weather system is going to be doing for us. First of all, a lot of cloud cover that's moved in. Check out this big trough just dominating. I'm going to get rid of that high there. This big trough dominating the Pacific, and that's going to be continuing to bring us that onshore flow over the next several days. And you see the rain already showing up here in portions of the northwest part of the country. There's that low. So as it comes through tonight, it's going to really thicken up that marine layer. The front associated with it is going to wash out, but we get enough oomph from this system and enough moisture at the coast that we're going to see the clouds push all the way inland and at the coastal slopes and even into the valleys. It'll be so thick that we could see some light rain come about, and it looks like the clouds won't even clear out by 10, 11 a.m. for some of the inland areas, which is pretty long time for those clouds to hang out. And as a result, that's one of the factors that keeps us very cool for tomorrow. 73 in Los Angeles, even cooler than it was today. The mountains are going to be very cold in the morning, near freezing for the next few days. Temperatures only topping out in the 60s and only 75 Riverside. Yeah, Riverside, only 75 degrees. All right, 74 cast, LA Metro in Orange County. Powered up by AccuWeather, we get a 20% chance of rain tomorrow. And then we'll keep those temperatures in the lower to mid-70s for a few days. Another trough moves through. Another system on Saturday brings us a slight chance of drizzle then. Temperatures stuck in the 70s throughout. Definitely fall is here. All right, valleys, i.e. lower 70s tomorrow with a 30% chance of some light rain. Into the weekend, we had, it looks like, drizzle possible on Saturday as well. You're staying in the 70s, too. Mountains, look at the lows in the morning, 34 to 32 on Friday to start things off. Coastal slopes could see some light drizzle Wednesday morning. High desert will keep you dry, but it will be breezy with temperatures right there in the mid to upper 70s throughout your 70 forecast. We have another look at this weather coming up in a few minutes.
It looks great, Jonathan.
Yeah, I like it.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Tonight, a big debate about Facebook and Apple and a perk they are now offering their female employees, covering the cost of freezing their eggs. Is it strictly generous or a sly move to encourage women to put off motherhood? ABC's Mara Schiavo-Campo is hearing from both sides.
A new perk for working women. Tonight, tech giants Facebook and Apple confirming they will pick up the tab for female employees who freeze their eggs, becoming two of the first and biggest companies to cover costs for this expensive fertility treatment. $10,000 to $15,000 on average, plus $500 a year for storage. A benefit some working women, like Ty Beauchamp, wish they'd had.
It cost me about $13,500.
Last year, the 36-year-old style expert paid out of pocket to freeze her eggs after realizing her professional success had delayed her dream of starting a family.
I know at some point I want to have my own biological children as well as adopt.
It's part of the new benefits package that includes in vitro fertilization and adoption coverage. But does it send the message that work comes first and family can wait?
Would you want your employer to do something like this?
I'm in favor of things which level the playing field.
I think it means that they want women to put their employment, put their career in front of starting family.
I hope it'll catch on. I hope more companies will see how great this is for women in general.
The good is that it empowers women and gives them more choices. The bad is it communicates a message to women that their workplaces may not be tolerant to women who decide to have children on the job.
New options for women who worry about clocking in and their biological clock.
Doctors say fertility drops dramatically with age and advise women who have decided to freeze their eggs not to put it off. Mara Esquivel-Campo, ABC News, New York.
Up next, who's claiming Los Angeles has a big rat problem?
Plus, you use Dropbox. Hackers may have hit it. What you need to know. And this story.
I'm in the process of swearing out a declaration for an arrest warrant for you. Would you like us to go through?
An Eyewitness News exclusive. See the video of two L.A. County Sheriff's Department sergeants threatening an FBI agent with arrest. Stay with us. A warning for Dropbox users. Anonymous hackers say they've stolen nearly 7 million Dropbox username and password combinations. The group has posted hundreds of emails and passwords online and is threatening to release more unless they are paid a Bitcoin ransom.
In a blog post, Dropbox is telling users their stuff is safe, claiming the information was stolen from unrelated services, not Dropbox. Dropbox says it monitors for suspicious activity and will reset passwords when necessary.
New York has a reputation for its rats, but it turns out L.A. has an even bigger rat problem than the Big Apple. That's according to the pest control company Orkin. They ranked America's most rat-infested cities based on the number of rodent treatments performed in each year of the city last year. New York certainly has its share of rats, as you can see in the video right there, but it ranks just fourth on the list. Los Angeles is ranked the second most rat-infested city in America. As for the number one on the list, that dubious honor goes to Chicago.
Apparently New York's rats are the friendliest, though.
Oh, gosh, very social. Oh, goodness, that would get me sitting up on the chair.
Well, coming up here, we are updating the evening's top stories next at 8:30, including a live update on the police activity shutting down a major Southland freeway.
Plus, an Eyewitness News exclusive, we go inside the case that's sending seven former Sheriff's Department officials to prison.
And what caused a double-decker commuter bus to flip on its side, all next at 8:30.
Your mouth will be open through all of this, even though Colin will be reading and all that.
So I should not cursing softly under my breath or
right.
Crying.
Right. Okay.
Yeah, 60 freeway shut down completely in both directions at Euclid.
Eyewitness News on LA 56 with live breaking news.
Breaking news, the 60 freeway shut down in Ontario because of police activity. I'm Colleen Sullivan. This is Eyewitness News at 8:30 on LA 56.
I'm Mark Brown in for David Ono. You're looking at live pictures there from Air 7 HD, and you can see the traffic on the 60 freeway in both directions at Euclid completely shut down, as is Euclid Avenue. It's because of a man who was reported to be suicidal, holding an 8-inch knife, keeping police at bay, and the traffic nightmare that is resulting is substantial. As you can see, freeway backed up for miles in both directions. People having to stay out of the area right now, that's what they're suggesting, while they try to figure out a way to get this man off. Right now he is on the freeway, which is over the level of the surface street at Euclid. He's basically hanging over one side and threatening to either jump or to attack whoever's comes close. So that's what we have here, is a standoff. And until it's over, the traffic is going to be an absolute nightmare on the 60 freeway in Ontario.
All right, Mark, thank you. And our other big story, an Eyewitness News exclusive, a mother speaking about a nanny caught on video abusing her two young children. The video shows nanny Dana Cash at times hugging the one-year-old boy. Then in another shot, when the boy's twin sister, her patience seems to break. The video shows her shaking the child as well as putting her hand on her mouth and telling her no. The children's mother says Cash had a clean record according to her research.
She was nice. We did a trial period. She was good with my older kids.
Tonight, Cash is out on bail. She has not been arraigned yet. The case remains under investigation.
The FBI is going to come to your house and they're going to manipulate you like you're a puppet? I don't think so.
You give me a cigarette, cheeseburger, and a soda, we can sit down and talk, man. Don't make me no difference either way it goes.
It's an Eyewitness News exclusive. We go inside the case that pitted the LA County Sheriff's Department against the FBI, sending seven sheriff's deputies to federal prison. Those seven former deputies, sergeants, and lieutenants were convicted of obstructing an FBI investigation into brutality and corruption in the jails by hiding an FBI informant. For the first time, you're going to see and hear the evidence against them, beginning with the video of two sergeants threatening to arrest an FBI agent for simply doing her job. This is an Eyewitness News exclusive.
Hi, I'm Sergeant Craig from the Sheriff's Department.
September 26, 2011. This crucial moment recorded by a Sheriff's Department surveillance team.
You know that you're named suspect in a felony complaint?
But that was a lie, one of the false statements to the FBI that's sending Sergeant Scott Craig to prison.
I'm in the process of swearing out a declaration for an arrest warrant for you. Would you like us to go through who?
I would prefer that you would actually contact the FBI.
Later that night, Sergeant Craig and his partner Maricela Long got a frantic phone call from Agent Leah Marks's FBI supervisor.
Indicate to me that you guys indicated to me there's going to be a warrant for her arrest.
There's going to be.
Another false statement to the FBI. The call ends, but the tape recorder is still rolling.
They're scared. They're like, do you know when is the warrant being
issued? You're still rolling.
That contempt for the FBI seen in emails as well. Lieutenant Steve Levins referring to the FBI as spoiled children, pitiful, and idiots. In one recorded interview, Levins tells Deputy Gilbert Michelle, who'd been caught in the FBI sting operation, that he's being manipulated by the FBI, that he's a pawn in their little game.
Is this just about a cellular telephone, Gilbert?
No, sir.
What's this about? Open your mind up here a little bit.
It's about they're trying to bring down the department and find out information.
Michelle, who are they trying to use to do that?
Me, sir.
Thank you.
Michelle had already confessed to taking a cash bribe from an undercover FBI agent to bring a contraband cell phone in to an inmate-turned-FBI informant, Anthony Brown.
And the FBI is going to come to your house and surprise you at your home, invade the sanctity of your home, and come there and talk a gangload of to you and threaten you?
The witness tampering appears to work. At the end of the interview, Michelle turns against the FBI.
I mean, the FBI and... You know, I see what they're doing. They're trying to bring down the department. But, I mean, I'll do whatever it takes for the department.
Sergeant Craig orders Deputy Michelle to not talk to the FBI.
That's your girlfriend. That's the FBI. That's anyone, okay?
Then there's Anthony Brown, the inmate at the center of this case. He is interviewed repeatedly.
You're not even seeing me, are you?
Brown, seen here in the 2009 crime spree that landed him behind bars, tells the Sheriff's Department the FBI has been gathering evidence inside the jail for years.
They're going to come through that front door, M16, go all that.
Deputy Gerard Smith seems convinced early on that Brown is connected to the FBI.
I know you're working with feds, dude.
Brown tells the deputies the feds are coming to clean the Sheriff's Department's house.
I'm going to tell you now, they're going to clean the house. Believe me, there's enough evidence on a lot of motherfucking in here.
That doesn't go over well with Deputy Smith.
All right, if someone's coming in my house to clean it up, they better knock on my door first.
Brown tells the defendants the FBI promised to pull him out of the jail after his cover was blown.
Never come back for you.
They haven't come back for Brown because they don't know where he is.
And after weeks hidden away from his FBI handlers, Brown writes this letter denouncing the FBI. "I will not testify for the FBI," he writes. "The FBI has left me for dead." Anthony Brown did end up testifying before a grand jury, but he was never called to the witness stand by either side in the trials of those Sheriff's Department officials. Brown is back at state prison now, serving his 423-year sentence. The seven convicted deputies are expected to begin serving their prison sentences early next year.
High-tech devices help locate a woman who veered off a road on Mount Hamilton in San Jose and spent the night in a ravine. Authorities say the woman's vehicle went off the road early Monday afternoon. This morning, rescuers found the vehicle using the vehicle's communication system but could not find the driver. Her family used a cell phone app to track her, and she was airlifted to safety.
Currently, she's moderately critical condition, injuries to the lower extremities and the abdomen. She was able to talk to us.
The woman's vehicle was 500 feet down the ravine. The public information officer said steep terrain and heavy brush made the rescue difficult. The woman was rushed to the hospital.
A road trip takes a frightening turn as a double-decker commuter bus flips on its side. About 50 people were on board the mega bus when it overturned near Greenwood, Indiana. Cell phone video shows the chaos after the crash. The driver says he was trying to avoid an accident that happened 10 minutes earlier, but when he swerved, the bus went into the median.
The scariest moment was about half. Like I said, when I was rolling around, not knowing what was going to happen, I just didn't know.
One person has critical injuries, four have moderate injuries, and 14 people are recovering from minor injuries.
The city of Steel Beach will continue a controversial plan to trap and kill coyotes. The council there voted to extend the program that's been in place for about a month after residents complained coyotes had been killing their pets. So far, three coyotes have been killed. The trapping will continue for at least another 3 weeks.
Supporters of Proposition 45 requiring public notice for health insurance rate changes delivered a load of steer manure to the Blue Shield offices in El Segundo.
Hey, hey! Ho, ho! Blue Shield BS has got to go!
Prop 45 would require health insurance companies to justify rate hikes and get approval for rate hikes from the state insurance commissioner. Consumer Watchdog says the opponent's $37 million campaign against Prop 45 is false and misleading.
You would never know from the advertising that four health insurance companies, including Blue Shield, has spent trying to kill Prop 45, that insurance companies are even involved.
In a written response, the No on 45 campaign says Consumer Watchdog is hiding its donors, saying so far more than $1.1 million in dark money has flowed into the Yes on Prop 45 campaign. And the statement says Consumer Watchdog describes itself as a consumer group, yet unlike Consumers Union and other credible consumer groups, it has no members.
A controversial new ad heats up the governor's race. It shows a child nearly drowning before being rescued by Republican candidate Neil Kashkari. Eyewitness News reporter Alex Michelson has more on its message and why political experts think it won't work.
The Kashkari campaign ad starts with a child drowning in a pool. It claims that Jerry Brown has betrayed children. Then the kid is rescued by Neil Kashkari.
I'm Neil Kashkari. I'm running for governor because every kid in every neighborhood deserves a good education.
Kashkari is referencing a recent court case where some students sued the state claiming that California's teacher tenure system is unconstitutional. The kids won in court. But Governor Brown is joining the California Teachers Association, a major campaign donor of his, in appealing that ruling. Kashkari's spokesman says, quote, "The governor had a choice, fight for the children who need him or protect his donors. He chose his donors and he should be ashamed of himself." Raphael Sonnenschein of the Pat Brown Institute says this ad is a ridiculous way to make that point.
This is the kind of thing you do at the beginning of a campaign when you're a long shot and you do something just to attract attention. If when you're doing it at the end of a campaign, it probably means that you've pretty much thrown in the towel.
Governor Brown hasn't responded publicly to the ad, but his campaign manager tweeted, quote, "Delusions of grandeur equals when a candidate calls self-transformational and stages ad of him saving a drowning child."
As governor, I'll cut taxes.
Kashkari used flashy ads during his victorious campaign in the Republican primary.
First up, Jerry Brown's crazy train.
Despite unusual campaign videos ever since, including spending a week as a homeless person, Kashkari has failed to connect with most voters in the general election.
There you go. One more.
Governor Brown is leading in most polls by about 20 points and is mostly ignoring Kashkari.
You don't really have much expectation to win.
Brown only agreed to one debate. Brown's campaign ads don't even mention the fact that he's running for governor. They push propositions instead.
Vote yes on 1 and 2.
It's a safe strategy, and it clearly is a successful one. I'm someone who's allergic to making predictions, but there is no scenario I can imagine in which Kashkari can win.
The latest campaign filings show that Neil Kashkari has less than $1 million cash on hand to spend. Governor Brown, meanwhile, has more than $20 million. Reporting from the newsroom, Alex Michelson, ABC 7, Eyewitness News.
Grammy winner Alicia Keys wants to help make sure the lost girls in Nigeria are not forgotten. Keys took to the streets of New York City to help rally awareness for the 200-plus Nigerian schoolgirls who are still missing after being kidnapped by Boko Haram militants. The protest took place outside the Nigerian consulate to mark the six-month anniversary of the girls' disappearance.
Today is my son's birthday, and it is also making me stand in solidarity with all the mothers of the Chibok girls who have been abducted for 6 months and are still missing.
Bring back Audra! Bring back Audra!
Keys recently launched the movement We Are Here, which fights for social justice.
Some important health news up next tonight, including a new test for a dangerous virus.
And another reason why you might want to give the Mediterranean diet a try, what it can mean for heart disease patients.
Ah, those heat waves feel like they were so long ago with temperatures like we had today. The cold stuff sticking around for tomorrow and rain in the forecast. Details ahead. Stick around.
Enterovirus, the asthma-like respiratory illness, has been confirmed in 32 children in California, but expect those numbers to rise as the CDC has announced they've got a new test for the virus that's sure to result in more confirmed cases. Health officials have been hampered in their ability to process specimens suspected in cases of enterovirus. That's because current tests look at a number of viruses and can take a while to turn around. Now the CDC says this new test will help ease the backlog. The test can process up to five times more cases a day than previous tests.
Eating the Mediterranean way with lots of fish, olive oil, nuts, and veggies is a very heart-healthy choice. But a new study takes those benefits one step further. Researchers say following the Mediterranean diet may even help reverse certain types of heart disease. At the start of the study, two-thirds of the participants had metabolic syndrome. That's a collection of symptoms like a large waist and high blood pressure that increases your risk for heart disease and diabetes. After a five-year follow-up, researchers found 28% of those who had metabolic syndrome no longer had it. There are conflicting reports over the health of Muhammad Ali. His brother Rahman reportedly believes that Ali's condition from Parkinson's disease has deteriorated to the point where he rarely leaves the house, and that it prevented Ali from attending a new movie about him in Hollywood last week. But the Ali family spokesman released a statement this week saying, quote, Muhammad is doing fine at this point, adding that if Ali were having a major health problem, the family would make that public.
How long will our cooler weather stick around? Jonathan Novak has a complete forecast next.
And coming up in sports, a costly error for the Cardinals in Game 3 of the NLCS against the Giants.
Plus, have you ever heard of Core Monster or Costa Rica? They may become very familiar names to you soon. The program giving companies the boost they need coming up. We are talking a pretty comfortable change in our forecast as well as some drizzle, Jonathan.
Yeah, some light rain. Remember the heat waves? Remember
nope.
Those?
Yes. Nope. Yeah. Not at all.
Not at all. Good. Yeah. Block that out. That's a suppressed memory. Live Megadolphin 7000 HD will start there. Rain all the way portions of Northern California up towards Seattle right now. And that is a system that will be bringing, hopefully, me some
better speech. And also some rain in the morning, as we see. Clouds moving in tonight. LAX 67, I should say, at LAX 67, also in downtown. It was a very cool, relatively speaking, afternoon today. Temperatures were about 10 degrees below where we were just yesterday. Look at the numbers tonight. 64 in Burbank, 65 Temecula, a lot of 60s across the board. Big Bear, 51. By the way, the mountains going through the extended forecast. You get some freezing or close to freezing mornings ahead. A lot going on in the weather. Let's check out what's happening far off to the east real quick. Hurricane Gonzalo, now a major hurricane, 125-mile-an-hour winds. This could be the first Cat 4 hurricane over the next 24 hours in the Atlantic for the season, so that's a big one. Now let's go over to the east coast of the United States. A lot of rain moving through the east coast, up and down the seaboard, and so they're looking for some flooding, in fact, going on right now in portions of Tennessee, North Carolina, and for Virginia. Now our situation is this. We have a front that's going to be washing out associated with the trough of low pressure. The front will wash out, but we have enough moisture in the air that as we go through tomorrow morning, that trough will basically give us a very deep marine layer pushing all the way inland, and it's going to suck us in under those clouds and bring us some light rain potentially. And on top of that, that onshore flow keeping us very cool. Lower 70s for just about everybody at best, except Palm Springs, but mid-70s in the IE, 73 Mission Viejo, and 71 in Oceanside, 73 Covina, 75 Ontario. It's a very cool, relatively speaking, unseasonably cool day tomorrow. Now, 70 forecast shows we have a little bit of a warm-up toward the weekend, but we have another trough that rolls through on Saturday, gives us another slight chance of some drizzle just kind of eking out of the clouds and keeping the temperatures in check. So, for the valleys and IE, you're in the same situation. 30% chance of some light rain tomorrow. You get a couple of days of that kind of backing off before the next trough comes in on Saturday. Some drizzle in the morning. Temperature staying in the 70s. The high desert and the mountains are looking pretty good, except a few showers possible at the coastal slopes and the mountain areas. But look at the morning lows. 34, 34, 32 on Friday morning. Bundle up weather to head into the end of the work week in the high desert. Breezy. Temperatures in the mid to upper 70s will keep you dry, mild, and a little bit breezy. And Dallas has got the latest on all this coming up on ABC 7-Eleven.
Okay. Thank you very much, Jonathan. Sports now. The Tampa Rays made the World Series in 2008, much more recently than the Dodgers' last fall classic appearance in 1988. 37-year-old Andrew Friedman, who was the architect of that team with a much smaller payroll, is now the Dodgers' president of baseball operations. Ned Colletti will remain with the team as a special advisor to president and CEO Stan Kasten. A windy day in the Bay for Game 3 between the Cardinals and the Giants. First inning, San Francisco already up 1-0. Bases loaded for Travis Ishikawa. He rips it to right. Randall Grichuk gives up on it as it hits off the base of the wall and right. The double clears the bases for a 4-0 Giants lead, but St. Louis with more seventh inning playoff magic. Here it is, down 4-3. Grichuk makes up for that earlier gap. This is his second postseason home run. Solo shot to left ties the game at 4. Now we go to extra innings. 10th inning, runners on first and second. Gregor Blanco lays down the sacrifice bunt, but Randy Choate throws the ball away, allowing the winning run to score. The Giants have now taken a 2-1 series lead. On the ice, the Ducks wrapping up their road trip in Philadelphia. Anaheim Blue leads of 2-0 and 3-2 in the third period. The Flyers' Jakub Voracek beats Frederick Anderson, game tied at 3. After a scoreless overtime, they go to a shootout where Ducks rookie William Karlsson gives Anaheim the win. The Ducks finish the road trip 3-1 and open at home Friday night.
Teaming up with a Fortune 500 company can be just what a small business needs to succeed. And that's just what the Walt Disney Company is hoping for. Eyewitness News reporter Rob Hayes shows us how some select startups are taking a turn with the Disney Accelerator.
As the entrepreneurs on Shark Tank will tell you, building a business and keeping it afloat,
I put my whole savings into this company,
is a lot like riding a roller coaster. A nerve-wracking experience with ups and downs. Perhaps one reason why these business owners are turning to Disney for help.
It's not easy. It takes a lot of money.
Yeah.
A lot of money, a lot of time.
Chris Bergman is the CEO of Chore Monster, a company built around an app that helps get kids to do their chores.
You're here to see the demo of Chore Monster.
Chore Monster is just one of 10 companies handpicked to take part in the Disney Accelerator. No, not that kind of Disney accelerator. This is a business accelerator designed to get small tech companies up to speed. Disney gave each business $120,000 and access to its top executives to serve as mentors.
We have a lot of executives at this company who are pretty good at identifying opportunities that can really be big.
Execs like Disney President and CEO Bob Iger and other Disney leaders, helping companies like Costa Rica, which built an app that teaches young kids how to write code.
We've developed the whole app during our 15 weeks in the Accelerator. And, I mean, Disney does entertainment for kids the best.
But the Accelerator program is no charity. Now, Disney is hoping some or all of these companies are going to take off. That means big business for everyone.
We are investors in these companies. So if they explode, that's great for us, obviously, as an investor. They can actually add value to the Walt Disney Company from a partnership perspective.
This may be the Disney Accelerator's very first class of startups, but the company does have some experience in this realm, like Disney's show Shark Tank.
Sometimes you win and sometimes you lose.
The Accelerator will be back for another season.
This is the first time, but it will not be the last. We plan on doing it again next year.
Disney is the parent company of ABC7. In Burbank, Rob Hayes, ABC7 Eyewitness News.
And more news straight ahead here at 8:30. And ahead tonight on Eyewitness News at 11 on ABC7. More violence tonight in the Middle East. The latest on the new developments in the fight against ISIS. Plus, we will take you to the opening night of Scream Fest to show you the latest from the world of horror. New stories and all the late-breaking news on Southern California's number one late newscast. Eyewitness News at 11 on ABC7.
A decades-old Thanksgiving tradition is struggling to stay alive tonight. A local limo company has delivered hundreds of thousands of turkeys and trimmings to families in need.
But as Eyewitness News' Alex Michelson shows us, this year the organization may need your help in continuing this on.
31 years, the Jackson Limousine Service has given away more than 2 million turkey dinners. Most of those lining up for days couldn't afford the food any other way.
It's feeding all the other people that doesn't have food, and it's feeding us.
He gives us food.
He gives you a happy Thanksgiving?
Yes.
Yeah. Have you sold some of your limos to pay for this?
Yeah, so cars, limousines, so property.
E.J. Jackson says he's sold hundreds of thousands of dollars worth of property to pay for the food, but he's almost out of money this year.
If I sell anything else, then the company won't be existing.
Usually at this time every year, this whole area would be full of goods, but this is all that's here, showing the desperate need this year for help. If people don't step up and give, elementary school principal Haywood Thompson says many of his students will go hungry.
A lot of our students are homeless, and having that Thanksgiving dinner gives them a chance to have dinner with their families.
So when you're not driving this, you're volunteering.
I'm driving, I'm volunteering. Yeah.
Driver and volunteer Chris Mallory has a simple message for those considering helping out.
It is very important to pay forward.
To donate your money or time, head to turkeygiveaway.org. Alex Michelson, ABC 7, Eyewitness News.
Tustin police are accustomed to chasing fugitives, but not like this. Yeah, that's an emu on the lam this afternoon. Officers responded to a call of a bird on the loose in the 400th block of 6th Street. Chase didn't last too long. Apparently some folks in the neighborhood had already corralled the emu so it could be brought back to its owner's home. Pretty big bird, almost 6 feet tall, but officers tell us there was never any danger to the public.
All right. Well, thank you so much for joining us for Eyewitness News at 8:30 on LA 56. Law & Order SVU is next on LA 56.
Eyewitness News continues at 11 p.m. on ABC 7 and anytime on ABC7.com.